time to complete 4.5 hours to 270 minutes. You have about 3.5 minutes per question on average. I would suggest to spend 3 minutes. And the way you achieve that, as Silvia just mentioned, a lot of questions are repetitive. So on a lot of questions, you pretty much know what it is. A lot of them are exact same questions. And if you use the text that I suggest, they have labels, and one of the labels says repeated question. And there are a lot of repeated questions labels. Basically, what I do is I review the exams for the textbook updates. Is I run a query question against the past questions, and a lot of questions come up to be the same from 5 years, sometimes 10 years, sometimes 15 years, sometimes just from the last exam. So that is something to be mindful of as you prepare. And if you see that same exact question, may just, even without reference from the memory, can knock it down. And that way you increase your average time for the other questions. More time you have for more difficult ones, better you're off. As I mentioned before, do not leave anything blank. So minimum passing score 75%, 80 questions in total, which means you only need to get 60 questions right. So you have 60 questions, which are the borderline. And one of the suggestions that I would have to, if you are not sure, leave a question mark. Well, now you cannot do that on a bubble paper, right? You have to use screens, but maybe leaving something like a question mark on a scratch paper, right, that you have. And the scratch paper itself is, I would suggest to bring pre-numbered paper with the questions, right? So you can, you don't have to write the question name, question number. So that way you save yourself even a little bit of time right then and there. So if you have a question mark, you can come back to it later on. Everyone has their own system. I have system of check pluses and check minuses, and I have system of questions to make sure, like this one I'm totally sure. This one I am not so confident, right? If I have a question mark, then I'm probably not confident at all. That would be kind of science that I develop for myself. But various people have various science. So what's important is you have to adopt a probability scale that you yourself recognize and able to efficiently use as a time-saving technique. All right, now let's see. So single best answer rule. I mentioned that there is one single best answer. There may be more than one correct answer. If you see the question which has more than one correct answer, the basic rule of thumb is that the simpler the answer is, the more likely it is to be deemed a best answer from the customs broker examiner's perspective, because it's right out there, right? There will be questions which require a derivative knowledge, which require you to engage in some kind of two-step methodology to arrive to the other answer, all right? Usually, customs examiners will not deem that answer to be the best answer. So under the single best answer rule rubric, it is best for you to get, if you see more than one correct answer, pick the one which is more simple. All right. So after you pass, congratulations, number one. Number two, make sure you still still have your citizenship. Make sure you're 21 years old. Moral character. So moral character, I posted this video for those folks who who registered. And this video goes through various case law narratives about those unfortunate people who customs examiners did not find that possess good moral character. What they ended up is, it's all based on public record, what they ended up is going to customs and taking customs to court. Throughout the video, you will see how customs decided to be more smart about it. But basically, you can single out various aspects of individuals' behavior which customs deem to be blameworthy. Number one is the false statements and the fraud. This is probably the biggest reason for customs examiners to be for customs and border protection to be very careful, because if you have been convicted of fraud, and it can be fraud with respect to the government, like, let's say, welfare, right, programs, or it can be some fraud in civil cases, right? But irrespective of that, if there is a question of your veracity, then that means that customs will take a more careful look at you. That doesn't mean it's automatic denial, right? If it is shown that there had been everything fine, but there was just this one incident, right? And it was a long time ago, and since then you changed your lifestyle. You have done nothing wrong. Then this is a mitigating factor. So there is no really bright line rule for that. Another thing that customs looks at is the ability of ones to manage finance. And this is one of the reasons why part of the customs broker license includes the credit reporting requirement. I have a lot of issues with that, because the credit reporting requirements themselves, they're replete with errors. Let's say I get a bill, and I disagree with the bill because I think that statement is incorrect. I dispute that statement, and all I get is some administrative individual who follows 1, 2, 3, 4 and is unable to see what goes on, right? I still disagree with that. So what are my options? I tell them, no, I'm not paying you, right? Because this bill has been sent in error. And the individual say, okay, fine, we'll just report it to the credit reporting agency, and we'll go from there. This is a deep philosophical issue with the system, especially after the 2008 mortgage crisis, when a lot of families, a lot of folks who working, good working people, responsible people, who lost their income and could not uphold their mortgage due to the economic situation, nationwide, were all of a sudden found themselves in the credit reporting agency doghouse. So even though you could, Customs and Border Protection looks at the credit report as a factor, I think life and finance become so much more complicated that it cannot be the very determinative factor. Although, as you see in the discussion, there were denials based on that, but that period was pre-crisis 2008 period. I would say that it's very wrong. As I go through these exams, as I go through these lectures, I kind of tend to dive out to other parts of our society, of the issues that our society deals with, and this is the one of the things that I think it is very wrong to blame individuals and families for something which is a problem of the whole society as a system. And my understanding is that it was the systemic issue. It was not the individual issue. Why we had the mortgage crisis of 2008 and what has followed. But nevertheless, credit is a factor, right? It is not dispositive factor. It can be dealt away with by explaining what has happened. The third one is the criminal history, right? Again, it's non-dispositive, but one of the cases that I discussed was DWI, drinking and driving, right? Driving while intoxicated on continuous basis, right? That demonstrated a pattern of disregard for the law, and that if you disrespect the law, that means you are not worthy of having a customs broker license, and that can serve basis of denial too. Again, the problem is not the criminality itself. The problem is pattern, and the big thing is on emphasis on pattern of disregard for the law. We also discuss some of the outliers too, such as Petrofeso case, where there was a relative, I believe, niece of Gotti, who was a mob boss. Customs couldn't find any connection to the mob boss other than being a family ties, but they deny. And that person had a good reputational character, good references, no criminal history, passed her customs broker license exam. Customs said no, because you have ties to this criminal mob, we are not giving you the license. We have nothing against you, we just have issues with your association. And that brought out a whole can of worms as far as constitution is concerned, because one of the students asked me, can I be held responsible for what my father had done? And back then, fresh out of law school, I thought, no, you generally speaking, the son cannot be held responsible for the deeds of his father, right? It's different individuals, and then we had execution or the collateral damage of the cleric's son at the executive order that Barack Obama executed through the drone, executed the little boy who was U.S. citizen, born in Colorado. And before that, we had the Petrofeso case, and we also there was also a DA case that I talk about. Although it's really not clear. This is why I call them an outliers. Is this has to be something really grotesque going on, not necessarily with the individual, but something with the environment that individual is being surrounded by. And it's likely not be the case to many of folks who take this exam. But if you have concerns, we can discuss this obviously off the record, and maybe we can see. Most of the time when I looked at this, it's usually a good. Most of us have good moral character, and in my view, my presumption is people are generally good persons, and there is always a light at the end of the tunnel. So but irrespective of that, please watch this video on your own time, if your time allows. All right. So moving on. Now. Now we get to the examination examination preparation, not the procedural part, but the substantive part itself. So, how do you prepare? How do you prepare for the exam? And what would be the suggested method? Well, we already heard suggestions from Sylvia, right? So a lot of preparation, a lot of examination, a lot of self-testing of oneself. But where do you start, right? Where does one start in order to become better prepared? I have suggestions. Those suggestions and recommendations, they generally work. But it is really up to you to develop your own timeline. And the timeline, of course, develops on your work-life balance, right? Because if you have family support, that's great. If you don't, that's more tough. So you need to find time. But the starting point is to develop a breakdown of topics that you are likely to be tested on a customs broker exam. Not necessarily, but are likely. So the good starting point would be what I composed to be in the textbook. All right. So the textbook itself has outline of chapters, right? It's broken down in two volumes, and those volumes, they give you the starting point. The starting point, naturally speaking, is the point before the product leaves the foreign country bound for the United States. What must be done? So here, besides the introduction, you have what must be done. First of all, you have to have general awareness, right? Then you have to have knowledge of Incoterms, which are being integrated in the Code of Federal Regulations. And even if they're not integrated, some of them, like FOB, for example, the customs examiners still ask them, assuming that you know. So international commercial terms is really a must, because it really tells you where your responsibilities, let's say, as an importer start, and where other parties' responsibilities as an exporter end, for example. It will also tell you the calculation, especially on evaluation part, the amount of money you have to calculate as far as duty payment is concerned. For example, such one of the terms is DDP, also known as duty delivered paid. Customers, without you knowing what duty delivered paid is, you may find yourself at a loss on evaluation portion, because customs examiners will give you the invoice price and will say it's DDP, right? And that invoice price, by virtue of it being DDP, duty delivered paid, will already include the duties. So you, and then they'll throw a question like, what is the per unit value, something like that. That means you have to backtrack yourself, and you have to take the duties out before you try to figure out the unit price. FOB or X works would be another one. It is very relevant, and it is in the regulation that determines whether you include foreign inland costs. Let's say you bless you. You include the freight from inland China to the coast, or do you not include? Well, that depends. Is it on a, is it X works, and is it, for example, on a through way bill of lading, which is a part of the discussion of the valuation portion of the preparation. And then you go on classification. You must know the classification of merchandise pretty much before the merchandise leaves the country, because for once you need to know if it's admissible because of the anti-dumping duties or other things. For twice you have to import this part if it goes by C as part of importer security filing. There is a rule that requires you to report it before the merchandise leaves the country. So, and part of it is the reporting requirement for the harmonized tariff schedule. So, classification is extremely important. So the principles of classification commence.